So I need you to invite someone to be part of this session. Please invite someone. So please, as we go along, ensure to bring someone, invite someone to be part of this session. Share the video so that others could listen to it. Just ensure to share the video. I don't know, we seem to be experiencing a bit of hitches. Okay, but just ensure you invite someone to be part of this session. We are experiencing a bit of a network challenge. This keeps going on and off. Please just ensure to invite someone. I celebrate you. Invite someone in a very short time, in about 1 or 2 minutes time. We'll be on teaching spree, where we'll be dealing with this all important subject, especially as it affects the believers. So please, I need you, once you come online, just invite someone to be part of this teaching session. And I want you to be as participatory as possible. You're welcome, Bro Divine. I celebrate you, sir. I celebrate you. You're welcome. So please, once you just come online, invite someone to be part of the session. Invite someone to be part of the session, you know, and I would like to get your responses. Please, as you come online, I would like to get your responses to our discussion today. I would like to get your responses. Once you come online, just give a shout, press the love button, share the video so that others can be part of this, our discussion this morning. We are built to start by 9 Nigerian time. We are built to start by 9 Nigerian time. So, that is 11 a.m. East African time. So please, once you're online, just invite someone so that we can have a discussion. This all-important discussion this morning is going to be a great time. It's going to be a great time. So please, just ensure to share with someone. Let someone be part of this session this morning. And then let me know when you're on. Let me know when you're on. Press the love button, you know, share, you know, comment. You have your questions, please type your questions. I will see it and I'll answer it. Any question you have, just type it. I will see it and answer it. The Lord bless you. I celebrate you. I think this is MM, right? I'm seeing, this is a big girl that I had to. I celebrate you. Good to have you online with me this morning. So please just welcome someone to be part of this session. I celebrate you. So it's a wonderful time getting to share together on this all important subject, on the subject of marriage, divorce, remarriage, and multiple marriages. You know, this is very, very important because considering the time we are in, we are going through turbulent time in marriages. Homes are in disarray. Marriages are getting shattered every day. People marry and get to divorce and get to remarry. And some marry, divorce, and they stay like that forever. They don't feel like remarrying again. And some are dying in very turbulent and violent marriages. Very, very, very draining marriages. And they can't take a walk. They can't pray. In fact, they have prayed, they are tired already, and they are wondering, what is going on? How do I continue in this? And so many people have died, you know, untimely death. They have met their untimely death as a result of wrong marriages, you know, and so many things, you know, people have their different views about this, you know, and all of the issues. You know, most time, thank you, Bro Joseph. Thank you, Pastor Joseph. Thank you, God bless you, sir. I celebrate you. You know, it's a difficult topic. Some people don't want to talk about it, you know, but the truth of the matter is that as a pastor, you are a preacher, these are topics that you can't run away from. You have to talk about it because every day we keep seeing people with these issues. We keep seeing people, you know, being thrown down by life as a result of wrong marriages. We keep seeing people meeting their untimely death. You know, if you pastor an assembly or you have people who submit to you, who believe in your ministry, you see young men, young women, you know, battling, you know, with this issue of divorce, with this issue of remarriage. People people are going through stuffs in marriages and there are no solutions in view to it, and you know, we tend to keep quiet about it because we don't want to be tagged controversial, because we don't want to be tagged, you know, extremist or something, you know, because this is a topic that whatever stand you take, people must criticize you. If you take a stand, you will be criticized. You know, like I'm talking today, some people might just find fault with me instead of looking, you know, taking a look at what we are going to consider. You know, and I want to advise you on this particular subject, take your eyes off me as a person. Let's study the Bible together. Let's look at the Bible together. So take your eyes off me so that we can learn together today. You have your questions, I'll take your questions, you know, I'll take your questions so that let's learn together. So I need you, don't come into this session with a mind that is made up. Because if your mind is made up, you can't take anything out of this session this morning. I celebrate you. I see Prophet Enoch here, Dr. Enoch. Celebrate you. So good to see you around. So good to see that you are online. You know, it's a great time getting to study together this morning. God bless you, sir. God bless you. And every other one who is there, who I can't pick your name here because there is a coverage on the screen. I'm trying to pick everyone who is there already. Fall Idris is there. I celebrate you. Now, let's shoot now. Let's go straight into our discussion. Let's go straight to our discussion. Now, marriage by the design is a beautiful thing. God's design of marriage is a very beautiful thing. And when God created man and he instituted marriage, his intention was to see that man got the best out of marriage. So marriage was designed for man's utmost pleasure. For man's utmost pleasure. So it wasn't designed for crisis. It wasn't designed for issues. It was designed for man's utmost pleasure. You know, and that was God's disposition to it before he brought about marriage. You know, and over time, we have seen so many people who got married and their lives become better. And we have also seen people who got married and their lives become shattered. So marriage is designed to be beautiful. You know, so when you get married, is a thing of favor, like you have been blessed of the Lord. You are blessed. You know, so marriage is meant for that. But as we see in human existence and in human coexistence, we have seen crises, we have seen issues as it has to do with marriage. So many people who got married, and just like that, you see that their lives took a nosedive. You know, you see somebody who was doing well before got married, and somehow things began to go wrong, and eventually the person is not able to sustain the bearings of his life, and then everything gets scattered. You know, so there are so many people going through crises of marriage. But like I told you, the original design of marriage is not to see that man is in crisis and turmoil. No, but it's to see that man is blessed. It's to see that man gets companionship. It's to see that the life of man gets better. I celebrate everyone who is joining. Please, as you join, share so that others can join. And like I said, press the love button so that I can know that you are following our discussion. If I make a statement and it resonates with you, please, you can repeat that statement by typing it out so that we can see. And you have a question, please put your questions on the screen. I will read it out and then trust God to be able to answer your questions on this all-important subject. You know, so we'll start our discussion from the statement of Jesus in Matthew chapter 19 on this all-important subject, on the subject of divorce. Like I told you, divorce has been a very controversial subject all across time. All across time. You know, the Pharisees came to Jesus one time and they asked him a very, very important question and a very controversial one at that. You know, they asked him about the subject of marriage and divorce in Matthew chapter 19. If you have your Bible, we can open it together with me. Matthew chapter 19, they asked him a question, and it is the kind of question you could tag controversial in Matthew chapter 19. Okay, so they asked him a question about marriage and divorce and remarriage. You know, look at it. Matthew chapter 19, you start reading from verse 3. From verse 3. In King James now, the Pharisees also came unto him, tempting him. You know, I need you to take note, they were tempting him. They were tempting him. It was a temptation. And saying unto him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause? Now, this was a question. And I need you to take note of the statement, every cause. They asked him, is it okay for a man to put away his wife for every cause? Not any cause. Mm-mm. Every cause. Every cause. That every is intentional, is deliberate. And I'll show you. I'll show you. So they asked him, is it okay for a man to put away his wife for every cause? Now look at the way NIV puts it. Some Pharisees, this is New International Version, it says, some Pharisees came to him to test him. They asked him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every cause? For any and every cause? Okay, then Amplify, look at the way Amplify puts it. And the Pharisees came to him and put him to a test by asking him, is it lawful and right to dismiss and repudiate and divorce one's wife for any and every cause? So the every cause there is intentional. That is every reason. So is it lawful for a man to divorce for every reason? Now, they are making this statement because in the laws of Moses, you know, there are about 613 laws of Moses. There are 10 commandments, and then there are 613 laws of Moses. Now, in the laws of Moses, praise God, praise God. In the laws of Moses, there are some laws that are open-ended. In other words, they were ambiguous. They are controversial. You know, in law, there is something they call ambiguity. Ambiguity is a law clause that is open-ended. You can give it an interpretation, give it any interpretation, it will suit it. Now, before we explain this, let's look at the law of Moses as it has to do with divorce. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 24. If you are with your Bible, please open your Bible, Deuteronomy 24. Deuteronomy chapter 24. Now, that is the law of Moses as it has to do with divorce. And it is on the premise of this law that the Pharisees were asking the question they asked Jesus in Matthew chapter 19. It is on the premise of what Moses said in Deuteronomy chapter 24. Look at what Moses said now. Look at what he said. Deuteronomy 24, verse 1. When a man had taken a wife and married her, and it come to pass that she find no favor in his eyes. In other words, if I marry a lady and it comes to a point that, praise God, I think somebody is trying to ask a question here, please. I'll take your question later. I've not even started talking, so your question shouldn't come up yet. I'll ask all these questions as I talk. So just wait patiently. All the questions you are putting up, I'll get all of them answered. I'll get all of them answered. Now, look at this now. You know, the Pharisees were asking Jesus about divorce. And say, is it okay for a man to put away his wife for every reason? Now, this is the ground upon which they asked that question in Matthew chapter 19. Look at the grounds now. You know, in Deuteronomy chapter 24, and verse 1, when a man had taken a wife and married her, and it come to pass that she find no favor in his eyes again. If a man marries a wife and then it comes to a point that the wife doesn't have favor in the eyes of the man again, then because he has found uncleanness with her. Wow. Look at the law. Look at the law. The reason for this, for the lack of favor now, is because he has found uncleanness in her. Then let him write her a bill of divorcement. If he finds uncleanness in her, let him write her a bill of divorcement and give it into her hand and send her out of his house. Now, by the law of Moses, divorce was as simple as this. You know, I married you, I wake up one morning, I don't like you again because you are unclean, then I send you out. Now, what is the definition of uncleanness? That is where the disparity and the confusion and the ambiguity comes in. What is your definition of uncleanness? Now, this is the point now. Look at verse 2. And when she is departed out of his house, she may go and be married to another man, becomes another man's wife. And if the latter husband hates her, and write her a bill of divorcement. If another man is going to get married, if she doesn't like her, he writes another letter of divorcement. Now, it was as easy as this to marry and divorce by the provisions of the law of Moses. It was as easy as this. You know, I marry you, I don't like you again, I send you out, you go out there, you find another man, the man married you, and the man now hates you the following morning, he also sends you out. He gives her a letter, you know, and sends her out. Okay, he sends her out of his house. Or if the later husband dies, if the second husband dies, which took her to be his wife, her former husband, which sent her away, that is the first husband now, may not take her again to be his wife after that she is defiled, because she is defiled. For this is an abomination before the Lord. Now, this is a provision of the law of Moses. Okay, now this is a provision of the law of Moses. If I take you to be my wife and I don't like you again because of uncleanness, I can send you out. If you go out to marry another person and the person hates you the following morning, the person too can send you out. And if they send you out, you can't return to me again because you are now unclean. Now, I need you to understand it. by the background of the Jews, the Jewish background, the woman had no right whatsoever. The woman belonged to the man as a property. You know, just like the man acquires a car, acquires a land, that was how the man acquires a wife. So when you acquire the wife and the wife stays with you, the wife is under your care. The wife doesn't have a right whatsoever in this world to marry another person. And if for any reason the wife goes out by you sending her out and she goes out, you know, and then she gets married to another person, it was termed adultery. The only reason it wouldn't be adultery, which is punishable by stoning to death, was that you had to give her a letter of divorcement. Okay? And even at that, as long as the man is alive, the woman is considered a wife to that man, the first man. That is why the Bible says in Deuteronomy, where we read here, that if the woman goes out and then she gets married to another person and the person divorces her, she shouldn't return to the first husband, because by law it is understood that the woman is still the wife of the first husband. Okay? Now, the point here is that Moses said if the husband discovers on grounds of uncleanness that he can no longer marry the wife. Now, what is the definition of this uncleanness? You know, some Bible translation says unchastity. Okay? Now, I would have loved us to check in different versions, but for the sake of our time. But this thing, the term uncleanness here, is not clear. It is like, if I wake up in the morning and I say, my wife doesn't know how to take care of my house, I divorce you. My wife doesn't know how to take care of the children, she is unclean, I divorce you. My wife is on, you know, does her menstruation twice or three times a month. She's unclean, so I divorce her. So you could give any interpretation to this uncleanness. So even among the Pharisees, who were the professional interpreters of the law, this was a major point of contention. So it was a major crisis in the law. It was a clause that brought about a lot of crisis. Now, it was on this premise, because the Pharisees understood one of the most difficult questions to answer in the laws of Moses was this question. So they brought the question to Jesus and they told him, is it okay for a man to divorce his wife for every reason? Now, this is why they say every reason. Because Moses left it open. It's an uncleanness. So uncleanness can be interpreted to mean anything. So he said, can I divorce my wife for every reason? Now, this was the point. And Jesus said, now, Jesus began to teach the lawyers the law. He began to teach them the law. Now, look at his answer, and this is going to be our explanation this morning. Now, he began to talk to them from the blueprint of Christ, from the blueprint of God. The reason marriage was created and the design of marriage now became his response to their question. Now, look at it now in verse 4. He answered them, look at the way he answered. He answered them and said unto them, have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female? In other words, by the design of marriage, everyone was created to be married to one person. And this was meant to span through life. Okay, now look at verse 5 now. Verse 5. And he said, for this cause shall the man leave his father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. They shall be one flesh. So by God's design, marriage is supposed to bring two people together and to function in the order of a flesh, of an entity. Okay? So by the design of marriage, man is supposed to function with the wife as a unit. Wherefore, they are no more twain, but one flesh. So in other words, Jesus was telling them, you are talking about divorce. Marriage is not two people. Marriage is one body. So you are talking about divorce. It's like a man cut his hand and threw it away. Because they are no longer two, they are one. So if you are contemplating divorce, if you are talking about divorce, it's like man plucking one of his eyes and throwing it away. Now, this is the original design of marriage. This is the way marriage was designed to be. Such that the two become one flesh, one inseparable flesh. That you can't put away your hand, just like you can't put away your hand, you can't put away your leg, or you can't pull away your kidney because it is not functioning well, or you can't pull away your eye because it's paining you. Okay, now that is the way marriage was originally designed. Now Jesus took them to the beginning. But let's continue. He took them to the beginning and told them, you are not meant to contemplate divorce at all, because man was not meant to marry and divorce. That was not the original plan. No. Okay, verse 7. They say unto him, why did Moses then command to give a writing of divorcement and to put her away? So you are saying the children divorce. So why, how come Moses gave an authorization for us to divorce? Now, the original plan was that there should be no divorce. How come along the line there was a permission for divorce and a condition upon which you can premise your divorce? So how come? What brought about it? Okay, so the people originally were not designed to divorce, but Moses came face to face with some situations that he had to give permission for divorcement. He had to allow for divorcement. You know, when I see some pastors ranting, you know, when I put up a post recently about, that someone can pull out of a turbulent and a violent and life-threatening marriages, you know, I was inundated with calls, with messages. My messenger was full, my WhatsApp was full. Why are you endorsing divorce and all of those things? So, you know, and all of that. You know, the point is that Moses came to that point. Apostle Paul came to that point as well, that they had no option but to proffer a solution by the mind of Christ. Okay? Because all men have no faith. Look at what he said now. Look at what he said. I think verse 7 also. Verse 7, right? Okay, let's look at that together. Verse 7. Verse 7. They say unto him, why did Moses then command us to give a writing of divorcement and to put her away? So the condition Moses gave was that if you want to put your wife away, it's fine. If she's unclean, you want to put her away, it's fine. But ensure you give her a divorce letter, so that she can carry that divorce letter to show to people that I didn't run away from his house. He was the one that sent me away and gave me a letter to validate his intention. So the lady can show the letter so that she could be accepted into the society, so that she wouldn't be killed as well. Okay? So you must give the letter of divorcement as an evidence to the fact that you have divorced her legally. Okay, so they say, how come Moses gave us the permission? And he said unto them, Moses, because of the hardness of your heart, suffered you to put away your wife. But from the beginning, it was not so. So there was a situation that warranted the involvement and the engagement of Moses in the dimension that he did. And Jesus went ahead, you know, to give that condition. And he said, it is because of the hardness of your heart. So the condition that Moses gave about the uncleanness, the interpretation of the uncleanness from the standpoint of Moses, even though it wasn't clear, was the ground of infidelity, was the ground of adultery. Okay? So Jesus was explained it to them. Okay? Now look at verse 9 now. Look at verse 9. And I say unto you, whosoever shall put away his wife, except it be for fornication. Now Jesus was talking in line with the provisions of the law, like we read in Deuteronomy chapter 24, verse 1 to 3. He was talking in line with that provision, the provision of uncleanness. And he said that uncleanness is sexual impurity, that is adultery. Because man was designed originally to be one flesh in marriage. If the man steps out, or if the woman steps out, by the provision of the law, it was the woman actually that was not permitted to step out, because the man could marry more than one wife by the provision of the law of the Jews. You know, so if anybody steps out, if the lady steps out, it means she has defiled that union, and then the man was right to send her away. Okay, so Jesus said the impurity, the uncleanness that Moses talked about was adultery. So if anybody is to send the wife away, it must be on the condition of adultery, because there was a massive recklessness that besieged the land, because they saw that Moses had given them a soft landing and they gave a good reason to send their wives packing. So when the wife didn't cook well, they sent her away. When the wife talked rubbish, they sent her away. When the wife, you know, just greeted someone in the market square, they sent her away. So Jesus said, no, you can't send your wife away for every reason. Not for every reason. It must be on the ground of adultery, by the interpretations of the laws of Moses. It must be on the grounds of adultery. Okay? So, if anybody ever sends a wife away, except on that ground, biblically, what it means, going by the blueprint of marriage, what it means is that you have separated a great part of yourself, and you are going to embrace another part, which was not originally meant to be so. So, it will be termed adultery, if anybody does that. Praise God. So by the provision of the law, like we see, the law of Moses and the interpretations of Jesus, one ground for divorce is adultery. And Jesus extrapolated further and he said, the second condition, what even brought about divorce, appearing from adultery is because of the hardness of heart. Because of the hardness of heart. Human heart is so desperate, it's so wicked, it's so tough. You know, so somebody can be married, and then in the marriage, he doesn't allow the Spirit of God to use him. He doesn't allow the expression of the fruit of the Spirit through him. He doesn't allow the mind of God to be expressed through him. He doesn't allow the abilities of God and the love of God to be expressed through him. It becomes a hardened heart. And Jesus said, on that ground, Moses permitted for divorce. Okay? So, the ground was on adultery, but what even what brought about the grounds of adultery is a hardness of heart. Is the hardness of heart. So we can extrapolate right now that one provision by the law for divorce is adultery. And the second provision is a hardness of heart, which tends towards violence and all of that, and all the vices we find around in marriages. Like I told us, you know, sometimes we can tend to prove that we are very spiritual, don't even talk about divorce at all, don't even mention it at all, don't even suggest it at all, don't even bring it up at all, and all of that. But man, when you see situations in life, you proffer solution even beyond what Moses proffered. Yeah, you proffer solution. Praise God. You know, some 4 or 5 years ago, there was a marriage that was going through crisis. You know, the lady somehow was related to me by blood. And I got involved in the marriage. I got involved in the crisis from day one. She has been carrying me along. The husband is a bully by excellence. You know, so any little thing, twa, beating, any little thing, he'll beat her, the lady will faint. Beat her, the lady will faint. It was a normal thing. I went there several times, trying to settle them, prayed for them several times, counseled them several times, and this continued. And there was no hope at all in view. And this continued for a long time. You know, the man would give her 500 naira to make soup. If she made the soup and the soup was not good enough, the man would come back from work and start beating her, slap her, beat her, carry knife, injure her, you know, use spoon, fork, injure her, up and down. Say, why would you cook soup like this and it's not sweet? With 500 naira that I gave you, it's not enough to cook a good soup. And then the beating was terrible. And, you know, I tried to intervene, no way. So eventually I felt, okay, let me talk to her. So I spoke to her, I said, okay, anytime he gives you that 500 naira, don't complain again. Don't tell her anything, call me, I'll add money for you so that you can cook good soup for him. So she now started calling me. So she called me, I gave her money to add to the 500 naira to cook good soup for the husband. And then she cooked the good soup, put meat inside and all of those things. And the husband came back and ate the food and said, tasted the soup and said, what? I gave you only 500 naira. How come 500 naira did this kind of soup with meat inside? You must be having an affair outside. And then another round of beating. Beat her. In the 8th month of her pregnancy, she was pregnant. In the 8th month, the husband beat her until she bled and passed out, fainted. So it took neighbors. The husband abandoned her, wore his clothes, and went out. So it took neighbors to come around and gather her and took her to the hospital before she was able to revive after being on oxygen and all manner of things. And then after the whole thing, I just felt, okay, let's take another step further to see how this thing can be reconciled. So I spoke to someone who is much older than me by age. And then I told him, okay, let's go to his office and see. Let's talk to the people. Maybe he will, because this guy doesn't respect anybody. Whoever you are, doesn't respect you, you know. Nobody doesn't respect a father, doesn't respect an uncle. Nobody. You know, so, and then I keep telling young people, when you want to marry, because the future of every marriage begins from the choice of who you want to marry. Yeah, begins with the choice of who you marry. When you want to marry anybody, check. You need to know, the person at least must respect one person in his life. The person must have an authority figure in his life. There must be somebody you should report that person to in case he's misbehaving. This guy never had anybody like that. He was the Alpha and the Omega. So I just felt, I spoke to the older person. I said, okay, let's go to his office and, you know, report him to his boss and see if the boss will help us talk to him to calm down on these issues, you know, and all of that. So we went to his office and we spoke with the boss. You know, he worked with one of the organizations that carry arms. One of these organizations that carry arms, you know, he worked with Nigerian police, you know. So we went to his office And then we spoke with the boss, and the boss said, okay, I'll call him. So we sat there, and the man called him, Inspector, so-and-so, come. And he came, and he was on duty. So he came in with his gun. So immediately he saw us. We had explained everything to the man and all of that. So immediately he saw us, his countenance changed. So the man, the boss asked him, he said, these people came actually, they want to talk with you. They say this, they say that. And then he hit the table, bam, and took his gun and cocked his gun. I said, I'll kill somebody here. Is it by force to marry? My son is misbehaving and I beat her. Is it by force? Who are you to question me? And the boss, knowing the power of a loaded gun, of a man with a gun, the boss understood very well. When someone with the gun, you don't argue with him. You know? When he cocked the gun, the boss now say, Inspector, so-and-so, please just calm down. Just calm down. I am the one that called you. You know, I just want to ask you, because if somebody marries a wife and the wife is arrogant, the wife is disrespectful, the person should beat her. The person has to beat her. If you beat her, nobody should question you. So I didn't call you to question you. And if you say you don't ever want to marry again, no problem. Nobody can question you. So these people cannot question you at all. And all of you say, hey. So they just bring down your gun. Please bring down your gun. Uncock it. And just go out. When I finish talking with them, I'll give you the feedback. That was how I sent him out. So when I went out of their office that day, I called the wife and I said, look, any day you go back into his house, say you are married to him, you are quarreling, he's beating you, don't call me. From today, pack your things and leave his house. Any day his mind calms down and he wants to marry again, let him come, then we talk. Then you take him to your parents. Let him start negotiating again. And if he doesn't, forget about the marriage. You can't stay in that marriage and die. Because before this time, she had beaten him like 2 times. I had gone to his house to go and settle quarrel. He had used gun to chase me out of his house 2 times. One day I even went there with my wife, and he used knife to threaten us to send us out of his house. And nobody to be reported to. Then you now say you are a Christian, you are a pastor, and all of that. So you can't talk about divorce, you can't mention divorce. Okay, so a pastor doesn't talk about divorce, but a pastor can conduct burial, right? A pastor can do burial. You see, because God hates divorce. Yeah, God hates divorce. He also hates premature death as well. Yeah, God hates premature death. So there are situations that have bent the hands of normality, of normalcy. There are situations that have bent the hands of normality. So there are people with hardened hearts. There are people who are prone and given to violence because all men don't have faith. All men don't have faith. Now, that is on the grounds of the provisions of the law. That's on the grounds of the provisions of the law. Praise God. So, in verse 9, Jesus made it very clear that Moses gave a condition, and that condition still stands. But he said, the condition is that it has to be on divorce, on the grounds of divorce. And what brought about this in the first place was because of the hardness of the hearts of men. And that hardness of the hearts of men has not stopped. People are still hardened. They are still hard-hearted. Praise God. Now, a little shift from there, so that I can explain the next thing as I begin to go towards the end. I think some of us are writing questions. It's very, very difficult for me to see some of our questions because of the stand. The camera, the phone stand is covering some of our questions. I'm trying to read out what we have here. Okay. So, and Apostle Paul also gave his own suggestion, his own standpoint on the subject of divorce. He gave his own point. Though when we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7, Apostle Paul gave a very, very vivid point. Now, before I even talk about this, in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, okay, let's start reading from verse 10. Now, the expressions of Jesus, the stance of Jesus, is still in explanation of the provisions of the law of Moses. Okay? So we can say that those two are in line with the provisions of the law. The permission for divorce on the grounds of adultery, on the grounds of the hardness of heart, those are on the grounds of the law. But Apostle Paul spoke in the line of the New Testament. Let's look at it in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians 7. Verse 10. We'll read verse 10. Okay. he was talking about the subject of divorce. You know, Apostle Paul attended to a lot of questions in his epistles to the churches. Now, let's look at this together now. And unto the married, I command, yet not I, but the Lord, let not the wife depart from her husband. Okay? So, that is unto the married. The wife should not depart at all. Okay? Verse 11. And if she departs, let her remain unmarried or be reconciled back to her husband. You know, I told you something before, that by the provisions of the law of Moses, the woman had no right at all to marry, to even ask for divorce. You belong to the man. You don't have the right to say, I don't want to marry again, I want to go, by the provisions of the law of Moses. And it is a culture. You know, the law of Moses is not just a constitution of Israel, it is a culture of Israel. So up till now, the woman doesn't have the right in Israel to say, I don't want to marry again. Because, you know, the Israeli society is the men's society. It's the men's society. You know, so if you leave your wife's house, then you should go. But when you go, you don't have the right to marry because you belong to that man. You belong to him. You know, and let not the husband put away his wife. Don't put away your wife. Okay? So Apostle Paul had an issue on ground he was addressing. Okay, verse 12. But to the rest speak I. Okay, verse 12. Okay, speak I, not the Lord. If any brother had a wife that believed not, and she be pleased to dwell with him, let him not put her away. Now, Apostle Paul is, approaching this issue from the New Testament perspective. Now, while by the provisions of the law of Moses, everything was legalistic, everything was done by the law. By the provisions of the New Testament, everything is done by love. So in other words, by the provisions of Apostle Paul, there is no room for divorce. That is what he's trying to say. There is no room for divorce. You love the person, even if the person commits adultery, there is room for forgiveness. And that is true. We are led by love. So in the New Testament, your wife, you know, is caught in adultery, your wife does that, it's possible to forgive her and go ahead. And I have counseled people in this direction, and to the glory of God, they took into that counsel severally, not once, not even 10 times, you know, where a woman was, you know, fingered in adultery and all of that, and then the husband had to forgive her, and then they pulled her head and all of that, you know, and that depends on the surrounding circumstances as well, you know, so, and that actually depends on the ability of the person to walk in that dimension of love and to be able to trust her again. So there are so many things that, you know, could lead to that. And after all, the subject of the issue of divorce or whatever it is, at the prerogative of the person that is hurt in the marriage to determine what he wants to do, but by all means, he should be led by love. Okay? So, it says that if a brother had a wife that believed not, that is an unbeliever, he shouldn't send her away if she wants to stay with him. Okay? And the woman which had a husband that believed not, a woman who has an unbelieving husband, should not leave there. If he is pleased to stay with her, then let her stay, let her not leave. Okay? For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the husband, else were the children unclean. Praise God. But if the unbelieving wife departs, now this is going to be the third reason for divorce. Okay? In an event that it can't be managed. If an unbelieving wife departs, let him depart. An unbelieving partner departs, let him depart. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases. But God had called us to peace. So if you got born again, you are a Christian, your wife said, no, because you are a Christian, I don't want to marry you again. I can't marry a Christian. I can't do this. And she wants to go. Apostle Paul said, let her go. And you are not under bondage in that scenario. I'll talk about what he meant by that bondage. You're not under bondage in that scenario. So if your wife says, I don't want to stay again, the husband says, because you are not a Christian, I can't marry a Christian, you know, and all of that. In my family, nobody has married a Christian, so I can't marry a Christian. Pack your things and go, and all of that. The Bible says that if the wife lives in that condition, she is not under bondage. So Apostle Paul, by inference, is giving the only reason in the New Testament why the believer should consider divorce. By the provisions of the New Testament, this is whether you walk in love or whatever. After you've exhausted every possible avenue to convince the person, and the person say, no, you are a Christian, you can't stay in my house, then Apostle Paul say, okay, they can separate. They can separate. And in that scenario, the brother or the sister is not under bondage. So that is what he said. So by everything I have said now, there are three provisions that are clearly spelled out. Number one, on the condition of adultery. Number two, on the condition of the hardness of heart, when it becomes irrevocable, it becomes irremediable. And number three, when one believes and is not ready to shift his grounds for the other guy, when one is an unbeliever and is not ready to shift grounds for the other guy to practice, it's not tolerable, it's not ready to give room for the other guy, you know, to practice what he believes in, then Apostle Paul said then that becomes a good ground to call it quits. Praise God. And like I told us, these are extreme conditions. Divorce is not something you just wake up and want to do. You know, a friend who was shouting everywhere, wanted a divorce. I did everything to see that the marriage didn't work. The divorce didn't stand. That they come together, they settle the issues and all of that. You know, and then he said, no, I want a divorce. And eventually they divorced. After the divorce, we didn't see for about a year. And eventually we saw. And we're talking, how are you? How is life? And then he told me, this was what he told me. He said, Pastor Wesley, he was staying with tears in his eyes. I don't advise my enemies to divorce. Even my enemies, I don't advise them to divorce because of what I have seen in this divorce, because of how life has been after the divorce. So divorce comes with trauma. It's not something you just listen, like you come to listen to Pastor Wesley so that he can validate your thoughts, so that you can divorce. You are joking. You don't know the content of divorce. You don't know. So it's not something like you want to do. So you are looking for who to validate your thoughts and all of that. You know, no. It means you don't know what you are contemplating. You don't know what you are contemplating. So I've given three reasons, and these reasons are cogent. Now, I'll talk about the next one, and which is the subject of remarriage. If I divorce, should I remarry or should I stay like that all through life? The Bible is very clear on this. It's very, very clear on this. Now, there are complications about this because some people say once you divorce, you must stay and not marry for any reason. Say once you divorce for any reason, you must stay and not remarry again and all of that. Well, there are various schools of thought to this, but, you know, let's look at the Bible. In the words of Jesus, Jesus didn't say you must not remarry for any reason. Mm-mm. He said if the person must divorce to contemplate a remarriage, there must be good reason. And the reason must be in line with the provision of the law of Moses. So he said, the reason must be that the person actually was found guilty of uncleanness, of immorality, of unfeeliness. So if you divorce for any other reason outside this, then you must not remarry. Okay, look at verse 9 now of that Matthew 19. Look at verse 9 of Matthew 19. Verse 9. Okay? I really wish we can quickly get this. If you are with your Bible, just open it so that we can read together. Verse 9 of Matthew 19. Verse 9. So Jesus made it very, very clear. The only reason anybody can contemplate remarriage is if it is on the grounds of adultery. That's what he said. And he was still saying that from the interpretation of the law. From the interpretation of the law. Okay? Look at verse 9. And I say unto you, whosoever shall put away his wife, except it be for fornication, and shall marry another, committed adultery. And whosoever married her, which is put away, doth commit adultery. So Jesus said, if you put away your wife for flimsy reason, you must never contemplate remarriage. If your wife has not contaminated the union, the oneness in the body, has not defiled the body, has not messed up on the grounds of uncleanness, and you go ahead to take any step of divorce, then you are committing adultery already, and you are pushing her into further adultery, if it is not on that ground. Now, Jesus said this. So in other words, the only condition you consider remarriage after divorce is that the reason must be genuine, must be cogent, and it must be on this ground. Okay, now look at what Apostle Paul said. Apostle Paul is a New Testament person, so let's look at what he said together. In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 15. 1 Corinthians 7, verse 15, look at that. Please, if you are with your Bible, just open to that place so that you can check. 1 Corinthians 7, verse 15. Okay, 1 Corinthians 7, verse 15. So he talked about an unbelieving spouse. If an unbelieving spouse decides to go, then let him go or let her go. Verse 15. So, but If the unbelieving depart, let him depart. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God had called us to peace. That is why in marriages and in threats of divorce, you must take the path of peace. You must do your best to see that reconciliation is ensued. You must tread the path of reconciliation. That is the best. That is the best. So, but in an event that this is irreconcilable, then he said, let him depart. In that case, the brother is not in bondage. Which bondage is he talking about? Now, look at this. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Verse 10 and 11. Okay, where we read before. Verse 10 and 11. And unto the married I command, yet not I, but the Lord, let not the wife depart from her husband. But, and if she depart, let her remain unmarried, okay? Or be reconciled to her husband. And let not the husband put her away. Now, this is the point. This is the bondage. If you leave for any flimsy reason, you must stay. You must stay unmarried. You must still marry. That is the bondage. So, verse 15 says that if the unbelieving guy leaves, if the guy who doesn't believe leaves, then the believer is not in bondage. He's not in that bondage of staying unmarried and all of that. The believer is no more in that bondage. That is, if the other guy leaves, the believer is free. Say, I want to be a Christian. The guy says, no way, you cannot be a Christian. And all of that. And the fight is there. And the guy says, okay, I don't want to marry again on that ground. Apostle Paul said, the believer is not in bondage. That's what Apostle Paul said. Now look at another thing he said again in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 27 to 28. 1 Corinthians 7, verse 27 to 28. Let's look at that together. You know, the way we look at some of these subjects can actually be disturbing sometimes, because when you approach any biblical topic with a made-up mind, you can never get anything out of it. So let's look at it. Look at what he said, verse 27. Are thou bound unto a wife? Seek not to be loosed. Are thou loosed from a wife? Seek not a wife. Okay, remain unmarried. But, and if thou marry, thou hast not sinned. In case, for very cogent reason, your husband says, I don't want again, and every effort has failed. Your wife says, I don't want again, and every effort has failed. If you marry, if you remarry, you have not sinned. And if a virgin marry, she has not sinned too. Nevertheless, some shall have trouble in the flesh, but I spare you. Now, Apostle Paul was talking from his own bias on marriage. He said, it is better to remain unmarried like himself. That is the point he was talking about, because there are crises that come with marriage. Yeah? Crises come with marriage. So he said, if in an event that a person leaves and you decide to go and remarry, then you are free. That's what Apostle Paul is saying. That's what he said. So if for any reason your spouse say, I don't want again, and all of that, and eventually the person leaves, Apostle Paul say, you can remarry. And such a person is not in the bondage of you must not marry, you must stay together. You must stay like this forever, because it is better to marry than to bond. That is the word. It is better to marry than to bond. You know, I had this guy who had this issue one time, and the wife packed her things and left. And every effort to reconcile them didn't work for 12 years. 12 years. The woman refused. The woman didn't even want to listen to anybody and all of that. And eventually, I kept talking to the pastor. Why not consider this guy remarrying? Because they had sent people several times to go there to see how reconciliation could be done. And the lady was never ready. Every effort to... Once you call her and you say, I am calling on behalf of so-so person, mention the name of the husband, the lady will drop call. Every effort didn't work. And this thing continued. Until the vibrant young man was in church, and started having an affair with a member of the church. With a member in the choir, one of the units there. And then when that thing became serious, the pastor came under pressure to see how this young man could quickly remarry, because he saw the disaster that was coming already. He saw the disaster that was coming. But eventually the young man had to leave the church, you know, on several grounds of issues with young ladies and all of that, you know. So now that is the point. That is the point. You can't tell a young man who was just 33 or so and got divorced, and the wife, it was the wife that left, you say you must stay all your life. You want to kill her? Can you kill him? Can you do that? You know, I know of a man then. He was in his late 30s. I was a young boy then. He was one of the people who used to preach to us, well-respected man and all of that. He has issues with his wife, and the wife left. The wife said never over her dead body and all of those things, and the wife left. Every effort, the church committee, the church leaders kept going to see how they could reconcile for about 3 years. No way. And the young man came and said, I'm tired of staying. I want to remarry. And the church leader said, no. Didn't you hear what Paul said? Paul said, you must stay unmarried. I can't stay. I said, you must stay unmarried. This guy was a vibrant brother. And then after 1 or 2, 3 years later, you know, 5 years after the wife left, the guy just left, married the first one. The church people say, because you married without our consent, you are excommunicated. The guy said, no problem. The guy went and married second wife, and went and married third wife, and married fourth wife. I'm telling you life story. These are people, if I go to that town, I still see him till today. He married four wives. Because he felt, if church has chased me away already, there's no need. No need. And in that environment, almost every church is what I believe. So he went and married four wives. Because the church have put the issue of divorce above his ministry. And that is where we are getting it wrong. There is no marriage that is superior to a man's ministry. Ministry is superior at every point to a man's marriage. So marriage is not even supposed to be compared to ministry. Marriage is supposed to be something that, like the training ground for your ministry, the first point of your ministry should be your marriage. That is what it should be, not the other way around. Okay? So, in summary, I think I just have to summarize because it's been long. I never intended to stay this long. It's been long. In summary, marriage is good. Marriage is beautiful. Divorce is bad. Divorce can be traumatic. If you stay close to divorced people, you wouldn't contemplate divorce. You won't like divorce at all. Yeah? And it is also true that there are people who divorce and their lives become better. Okay? So, but marriage is good. Divorce is not something to be contemplated. And you can avoid divorce. The best time to avoid divorce is before the marriage, before you get entangled in it. You must seek the face of God. You must get to know the will of God concerning you. You must study the person. You must know the person. You must know his values, what he believes in. You must know the people around him, who are his friends, who are the people with fears and respect. You must find out all of those things. As I keep telling people, all the time you used to do all the social media and all of those things, use it to study the people. You are dating somebody. Find out about the person. And before marriage, give yourself over to expressing the fruits of the Spirit. Joy, peace, love, and all of it. Express the fruit of the Spirit. Become a changed person. Become a good person. And you transfer that into marriage. And this I am talking to the two parties. Because these are the things that will determine whether the marriage will last or not. Okay? So, but in an event that it is irredeemable, in an event that the condition is so terrible, then divorce is not a sin in that condition. That is in an event that you can't do otherwise. I've given you several instances of violence and all of those things, especially of violence. For me, in the New Testament, the only reason the believer should contemplate divorce majorly is violence, whether it is emotional violence or whatever. But violence, a threat to life and all of those things, you can contemplate it. And if for any good reason you have exhausted every opportunity for reconciliation, because after divorce, you should pursue reconciliation, okay, if necessary. Okay? That is, if the reasons are not as bad and life-threatening, you can pursue reconciliation. That is, if your partner leaves and it is not for any good reason, you can pursue reconciliation. But if reconciliation fails, and it has gone beyond every possible opportunity for you to reconvene again, then you can go ahead and remarry. Praise God. It is better to marry than to burn. It is better to remarry than to burn. And I've shown you some of those things from the scriptures. Okay? I think I just have to stop at this point. Like I said earlier, I can't do as much with some of our questions, but I'll try to see some of the questions we have put up. What is described as an unhealthy marriage, and when should a believer in Christ seek divorce rather than remain in an unhealthy marriage? I think an unhealthy marriage is any marriage where the lives of the people are threatened. Where their lives are threatened and beyond redemption. They are threatened beyond solution. Okay? So I think that is an unhealthy marriage. And when a believer is trapped in that kind of marriage, there is nothing out of place for the believer to seek a separation or a divorce. Okay? I'm trying to find out if there are any other questions. Okay? Thank you guys, thank you everyone. Pastor Joseph Assault, thank you so much. Dr.
Dr. Enoch, and everyone who has participated in this live session. I deeply appreciate you, and I'm sure, I don't know if I was able to do a bit of justice to what you think, and for some of us who feel I step on your toes, please take, you can listen to the video again so that it can become a little clearer. You know, it can become a little clearer. You can take another look at the video again so that you can get some clarity on that, on this subject. God bless you. God bless you. I celebrate you. Do have a wonderful time. If you have any questions beyond this video, you are free to ask me. Maybe outside the video, outside Facebook, you are free to ask me. God bless you. Have a wonderful time. I celebrate you. God bless you.